like I talk it, walk it, walk it like I talk it, walk it, walk it like I talk it, walk it like I talk it, woo, walk it like I talk it, walk it like I talk it, ayy, walk it like I talk it, walk it like I talk it, yeah.
What would you do if you were passionate about making your art? Would you pursue it for 26 years? Even if 3 years in, you received a 251-page official rejection letter? Even if the total cost of your project was going to be $20 million, $21 million, that you were going to foot all yourself? That you weren't going to recoup any money on because you were going to make your art free to the public? Would you pursue it for 26 years, knowing that it was only going to be up for 2 weeks and then dismantled and destroyed forever? What would you commit to pursue your passion? Crystal and Jean-Claude had made a career of making big, in-your-face, obnoxious things that you just couldn't ignore. I know a teacher or two like that. But some of their most famous works were rapping well-known objects, not, you know, like Drake or Eminem.
I'm MC Max Scott, and I am hot. She's DJ Jazzy Flex, and she is the best. All the sucker branches can suck off that.
Wicka, 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 what?
But taking them and making large cellophane or other wrapping items around them, such as Pont Neuf, the Riechslag, the London Mastaba. But each of these, while they highlight the work that's being wrapped, also seeks to obfuscate or obscure the work itself. The works of theirs that I really like are the ones where they accentuate or highlight things without hiding them. Like the Surrounded Islands in Biscayne Bay in Florida, they did in the 80s, where they surrounded these little islands with pink cellophane. Or the Valley Curtain in Colorado, where they used a familiar-looking saffron color across a great stretch. This unnatural color in both of these instances is something you wouldn't expect to see, but by having it there, draws greater attention to the natural beauty that's in contrast to the colors they put around it. That's what makes the gates so awesome. It's different than anything else they'd done before. It's like the best of both worlds. They're taking an area which seems like nature, though it itself is a man-made park, a construction, a work of art, of urban planning and landscape design that's in the middle, this oasis, this human oasis in the middle of the most urban setting in the world, New York City. And the beauty of the nature there, which again is contrived nature, is being highlighted by the momentous number of gates with the saffron sheets they riddled throughout. The only way to experience it, I mean, you can see pictures from a helicopter or an aerial view, but then it's just little specks of orange. What really makes it incredible was the 14 days that people could walk through the parks and travel the crazy pathways through the park through these sheets of orange saffron with odd shadows in the weather in February, making the experience in the moment as you, the passerby, experienced it, dynamic and different at every step. It's really crazy to think that this probably wouldn't have happened if it wasn't for the election of a very, very unlikely hero. Michael Bloomberg. Bloomberg, who had just become mayor of New York in 2001, was not only an avid collector of Crystal and Jean-Claude images, a big fan of Crystal and Jean-Claude, but he was also one of the members of the Central Park Conservatum, the other governing body that would determine what could and could not go in the park. So even though neither that organization nor the city itself had to fund the art, they did have to allow for these artists to build there. And with Bloomberg clearing the path for this almost 30-year struggle to finally be realized in 2005, from February 12th through 27th, this magnificent exhibition, this highlight that demonstrates the relationship between what art and what public space, and how public space interacts with art, and how people can interact in that public space, existed for 14, 15 days. These 16-foot high gates, 7,503 of them stretching across 23 miles, allowed people to flock to New York, people that already were in New York to go on the runs they've been putting off and experience this delight, knowing that on the 28th, it would all be gone, sent to recycle bins and repurposed. Why, after so long, would you, such a struggle to get this work done and finally having it, why would it only be up for 14 days? It wasn't a fight with the city or anything like that. Jean-Claude and Christo, they wanted it this way. The idea of having something so ephemeral, so temporary, it gives it extra value. When we know things won't last, they gain value. As we get older, we see our youth slipping away and want to hold on to it. It becomes more precious. Maybe you're thinking about the days coming up soon when you'll no longer live at home and you won't have this daily experience with your parents. This time is fleeting. It's precious. It gains more value. Human life itself, it's so brief, and the fact that it might disappear, that's what gives it ultimate value. By making these gates something that was only going to be there a couple of weeks, it creates value.